Covering antibodies, the aim is to discuss facts which form the basis of MCQ questions. As I have already sent the material, I'll move rather fast. The anti-nuclear antibody ANA is positive in 95% to 99% of cases of SLE. It is also positive in systemic sclerosis in about 40% to 60%, mixed connective tissue disorders, Sjogren's syndromes, and polymyositis, dermatomyositis. Also in rheumatoid. Remember that ANA is not positive only in SLE. It can be positive in other conditions. Now, how does one detect ANA? Now, an MCQ can also assess whether you know the methods by which ANA detection can be done. It can be done through indirect immunofluorescence. In indirect immunofluorescence, you read the pattern of fluorescence using fluorescent microscope. Then you have ELISA-based studies which detect antibodies. Then immunoblot and immunoprecipitation are other methods to detect ANA. From MCQ point of view, you need to understand some facts. Anti-dsDNA. Now, anti-double-stranded DNA is positive in SLE. It correlates well with renal lupus and CNS lupus. You could get a question like in renal lupus, which antibody correlates the best? The answer would be anti-dsDNA. Anti-Smith antibody is a specific antibody for SLE, seen in 20% to 40% of SLE patients. So you could get a question, which is the specific antibody for SLE? The answer would be anti-Smith. Anti-histone antibody is seen in drug-induced SLE. Now, so a question could be, which is the antibody seen in drug-induced SLE? The answer would be anti-histone. Now, which are the drugs used which can induce SLE? I'll tell you one drug, that is procainamide. I'll give you an assignment to read more drugs. In drug-induced SLE, usually renal and CNS involvement does not occur. Now, this is very important. Drug-induced lupus, usually the renal and CNS involvement does not occur. So, it is a milder form of SLE comparatively. Another important antibody is anti-U1 RNP. It's a very favorite question in MCQ. RNP is ribonucleoprotein. Anti-U1 RNP is positive in MCTD, mixed connective tissue disorder, in high titer. Anti-topoisomerase or anti-SCL70, these are positive in diffuse cutaneous scleroderma. Topoisomerase, SCL70 are the same. Anti-centromere antibody is positive in limited cutaneous scleroderma. Now, how I remember it is limited cutaneous scleroderma is also linked with the Kress syndrome. Kress syndrome has a C in it and so does a centromere. So, anti-centromere, Kress and limited cutaneous, they get linked like that. And what is Kress syndrome? Just to revise it, calcinosis, Raynaud's, esophageal dysmotility, sclerodactyly and telangiectasia. Anti-Rho and anti-La antibodies. Anti-Rho is also called SSA, Sjogren's syndrome A, anti-La SSB. They are positive in Sjogren's syndrome. Sjogren's is characterized by Sikka symptoms, dry mouth, dry eyes. And another MCQ question in Sjogren's is RTA type 1. Remember, RTA type 1 is seen in Sjogren's syndrome. The assignment for you is to read RTA 1 to 4 and sensitize and, you know, be sure about the various RTAs. Anti-Rho antibody in a pregnant lady increases risk of complete heart block in newborn. We need to keep facilities for pacemaker available, including either a pediatric cardiologist or a cardiologist who's trained to handle newborn. So if you may get a question that there is a lady of 29 years who's got anti-Rho antibody positive and she is going for delivery. So what further action should you take? So obviously they are looking at whether you understand that the neonate could have complete heart block, and you would be aware of this and look at having the relevant cardiac facilities available. Another favorite is anti-JO1 antibody in anti-synthetase syndrome. It is a subset of dermatomyositis which can have fever, mechanic's hand, arthritis, Raynaud's phenomenon, ILD, and myositis is less prominent. Now please remember, Mechanics hand and ILD, these are two things which you should always remember with the anti-synthetase syndrome. Remember, in dermatomyositis, we have certain characteristics like Scholl sign, heliotrope rash, V sign, and Gautran's papules. Gautran's papules are in the dorsum of the hand, over the fingers classically. Scholl sign, you can see the image. Heliotrope rash is on the eyelids. V sign is on the neck. Now you see, it's very important you see the images. You can get image based question also. Also see the images of immunofluorescence pattern in Google. One site is Euroimmune. Also ACR, American College of Rheumatology, images are very good. Basically, you may get image based questions also, as what we learned from the last exam. So this is, I finished with the antibodies. Now I will discuss the antiphospholipid syndrome. Antiphospholipid syndrome, actually I will start with the anticardiolipin antibodies. You can get a question as to which antibodies are tested for in antiphospholipid syndrome. Remember, all four are tested: anticardiolipin IgG, anticardiolipin IgM, beta 2 GP1 and lupus anticoagulant. All four have to be tested. So you could get a question where he is asking, where they are asking which of them are tested in this setting. Answer is all four are tested. It is a antiphospholipid is a hypercoagulable state. It can cause both arterial and venous thrombosis. Now from MCQ point of view, remember that arterial and venous thrombosis only occurs in APS and hyperhomocysteinemia. Venous thrombosis, on the other hand, occurs in protein C deficiency, protein S deficiency, antithrombin 3 deficiency, factor 5 Leiden mutation, prothrombin mutation. Remember, in all these conditions which I have mentioned, only venous thrombosis occurs, no arterial thrombosis. Learning point is that conditions causing only venous and those which cause arterial and venous, this I think you should be clear by now. APS can be primary or secondary. Primary APS is a disease per se. There is no underlying disease. Secondary APS is secondary to an underlying cause like SLE or dermatomyositis, etc. This is important to understand. SLE is a major cause of secondary APS. What are the clinical features of antiphospholipid? Read your textbook positively. I am concentrating on MCQs and you can read this chapter well. You will assimilate better. However, the important clinical features are recurrent pregnancy loss. This can be questioned in gyne-obs too. If you remember, I mentioned in antibodies about anti-Rho antibody and heart block in newborn. These questions can be in OBS too, obstetrics too, and this is an overlap. Now, most of these losses would occur after 10 weeks. This is very important. The pregnancy losses are usually after 10 weeks. We'll come to the Sapporo criteria subsequently. Thrombosis can be arterial, like this patient can have TIA, transient ischemic attack, ischemic cerebrovascular accident, stroke in young. Antiphospholipid syndrome is an important condition which predisposes to stroke in young. Then you can have venous thrombosis, like cortical venous thrombosis, deep vein thrombosis. DVT, as you know, classically occurs in the lower limbs, and this makes the patient prone to pulmonary embolism. Pulmonary embolism per se can also occur. Mesenteric thrombosis can also occur. Then less common, they can have neurological symptoms like chronic headache, migraine, dementia, seizures, damage to heart walls, and sometimes bleeding can occur too. Paradoxical hypothrombinemic lupus anticoagulation syndrome. Now, what are the risk factors for APS? It occurs more in women than in men, like SLE. Infections predispose, like syphilis, HIV, AIDS, hepatitis C, or Lyme disease. For your information, hepatitis C also predisposes to an entity called cryoglobulinemic vasculitis. So read that. Then medications like hydralazine. Additional points. APS is the most commonly acquired thrombophilia. Then there are Sapporo criteria. I want you to read these criteria and understand. Remember that criteria classification must be learnt well. May come as a question. In APS, fetal morbidity abortions are usually after the 10th week of pregnancy. This is something you must keep in mind. My assignment for you is to read the Sapporo criteria. Now, by now what you would have understood that I am teaching you what is tough. Why so many tough questions? I have analyzed your paper and I generally feel 300 questions, 100 are on the easier side, 100 are moderately tough and 100 are very tough or fairly tough. I am preparing you more for the tougher questions which will come. You need to get them for crossing 800 marks out of 1200. If you want to get into the first 1000 ranks in India, I can tell you that you have to have adequate exposure to all degrees of difficulty. Now, which are the other criteria or classification? I'm just getting off tangent. I was discussing APS, but now I'm moving to something to remind you that you need to know criteria. Sometimes they may ask, this criteria is in which disease? Like Apache 2 criteria. I'm giving you an assignment. Rome 2 criteria. ACR criteria, American College of Rheumatology. Light criteria for pleural effusion, exudative. Duke criteria for infective endocarditis. Chapel Hill consensus for vasculitis. NYHA classification for congestive heart failure. Child-Pugh classification for severity of liver disease. Poser criteria were the older criteria for multiple sclerosis. Now we follow the McDonald criteria. Osserman's classifications for myasthenia gravis. So remember, knowledge of the names of the criteria and the various classifications is very important. It's better you understand them well. And also not to forget Duckett-Jones criteria. You know what it stands for. So many more, master them will help in your exam. Remember, malignancies too have increased anti-cardiolipin antibodies and may cause increased thrombosis. Now, another MCQ question is catastrophic APS. It is something which has a higher mortality in antiphospholipid, about 50%, where basically thrombosis can occur in two or more sites. Infections can precipitate CAPS. In CAPS, kidney is the most involved organ, followed by lung, CNS, heart, adrenal glands, and the skin. There is an entity called SNAP, seronegative antiphospholipid syndrome. How do we treat antiphospholipid syndrome? Primarily, it is anticoagulation. Now, PT and INR is usually targeted to 2 to 3. This is important. This could be a question. He could give you a question like, INR is targeted 1 to 1.5, 1.5 to 2, 2 to 2.5, and the fourth can be, say, none of the above. Definitely, you go above 2. So, that's where he is testing that you need adequate anticoagulation. Now comes an important question. If a lady has recurrent pregnancy losses and anticardiolipin antibody are positive, how to anticoagulate and when to start? Now you could get an obs question. 30-year-old lady with history of 3 abortion after 10 weeks comes with history of amenorrhea since 6 weeks. USG shows cardiac activity in fetus. How will you manage this patient? Now the answer. Once the fetal cardiac activity is seen, we start anticoagulation. How do we anticoagulate? We can give low molecular weight heparin or unfractionated heparin. Now you will ask me, why plain heparin? LMWH is a costly drug, whereas many people may not be able to afford. And with unfractionated heparin, that is normal plain heparin, 5000 to 10,000 units 12 hourly, many patients are able to comfortably have a successful pregnancy. Continue till end of pregnancy and continue 6 to 8 weeks post pregnancy also. So this is all from my side. The basic idea was to give you an overview of antibodies pertaining more to the rheumatological conditions and to discuss some important factors like antiphospholipid syndrome. There are some conditions which tend to be, you know, you tend to get a lot of questions like sarcoidosis. Invariably, it tends to come more in the thing. I will cover that subsequently. Multiple endocrine neoplasia. It's a tough topic. You will always find one odd question coming. So basically, what you need to do is you need to secure what you know. You got to be very sure because you can't afford to lose your marks. Medicine has too many subjects under it. So sometimes you're not able to do a few topics, but What do you know? You should prepare well and secure it well so that you cannot, you don't lose out. Thank you very much.